who doesn't want love, right? It comes in different ways, but there's people who get it like nothing, and then there are those who never get it. It's painful, I know, but sometimes when people don't get it, they can turn into creeps in ways unexpected. It had been 4 years since Aiden had told Stephanie how he felt about her, but she ended up blocking him from her life because she didn't feel the same way. During those 4 years, Aiden tried to move on, but he couldn't. She was always on his mind, and it was a torturous pain, a reminder of a love he couldn't have. This day just so happened to be the last straw for Aiden before the transition. The day started normal, but for Aiden, it was another day in hell. Aiden woke up and began getting ready for school. When he was dressed, he grabbed his backpack and stepped out of his room and began heading for the front door. He grabbed the doorknob and began to turn it when his dad pulled him by the shoulder, saying, "Hey, you better pass your class or else." Aiden pulled his shoulder from his dad's grasp and said, "Leave me alone. I'm not in the mood today for one of your drunken speeches." As he was about to walk out the door, he was pulled. His dad pulled him by his backpack strap and said, "You listen to me, boy. I am your father." His mom said, "Stephen, let him go." That's when he turned and slapped her in the face hard enough that she fell. In that moment, Aiden felt his blood get warm and clenched his fists. His mom saw this and nodded no. Aiden saw her nodding and walked out to go to school. The walk there, he was just thinking and blowing off steam from what just happened. He wanted to beat up his father badly. He had even created scenarios in his head on how it would happen. Aiden knew that thinking dark things like this was bad, and even though his mom gave him all the love in the world, it wasn't the kind he needed. When he finally arrived to school, he walked to the back of the school to where the gym was, as he had PE for first period. Aiden sat on the ground and waited for one of the teachers to open up the locker room. There was about a 20-minute wait before someone actually came to open the locker room. Once he got inside, he left his backpack in his locker and didn't bother dressing for the day. He never did. He was one of the few that never gave a fuck about the dress rule in PE. So with that being said, he was also one of the first to be waiting for his class outside. Aiden was wearing his black hoodie and was listening to music the whole time he waited. Slowly, kids began to show up to the meetup area where they were told to wait. Kids began to get into their little friend groups to talk while the teacher showed up, but Aiden didn't. He was the lonely wolf, not because he couldn't make friends, but because he chose to stay a loner. This particular day, the teacher were taking their sweet little time to arrive. And due to that, kids began to walk around the field to pass time. Aiden was minding his own business, but from the corner of his eye, he could see a group of kids begin to form a circle. He thought it was a fight, but was wrong when the group cleared and saw Stephanie hugging another guy, and immediately he felt his heart break. Aiden knew that he would never get with her, but it still hurt seeing her with a guy. Aiden kept his head down, but he was still able to see through the corner of his eye that they began looking for something. It was clear to Aiden that they were looking for him. Now, one thing to note was that even though they had PE together, they were in different classes. Aiden was trying to stay undercover to avoid conflict, not because he was scared. Well, he was, but for the other guy, in case he got physical. Aiden to a point got angry that she didn't acknowledge him, but he was angry at himself, and the way he dealt with it was by learning how to fight and getting stronger. This did catch the attention of his mom, but he didn't care. He wasn't going to use it for violence. He was a defensive person. Only attack if they attack first. Eventually, Aiden was found by the newly made couple, and he tried to ignore them by walking faster and in different directions. But just as the guy was about to catch up to Aiden, the teachers arrived and called the classes over. Aiden avoided a probable defensive fight if it got physical. The guy backed off and Aiden walked to his teacher with the rest of his class. The rest of the class was just them walking around the volleyball courts, and everything went back to normal for now. When the teacher blew the whistle, everyone headed to the locker room. And of course, this was another close call, as Aiden avoided the guy again as he didn't have to change. So it was a just go in and back out situation. Everything went well for the rest of the day until lunch arrived. Aiden was in the back of the class buildings just waiting for the school day to end. But that's when they went down. Stephanie and her boyfriend Greg arrived. Aiden was just sitting there looking down. that he didn't see them arrive. He got tapped on the shoulder, to which he looked up and saw them. Aiden removed one of his earbuds and asked, "Yeah, may I help you?" Stephanie didn't say anything, but the guy did. "Are you Aiden?" "Yeah, what's up?" replied Aiden. The guy said, "I'm Greg, and I'm just wanting to say that Stephanie and I are dating. And just to avoid any problems, I wanted to tell you to maybe back off a bit." Aiden said, "Hold on. You're telling me to back off even though it's been years?" Greg replied, "Yeah, I know, but for God's sakes, can you please?" Aiden responded, "Hold on, I'm confused. You're telling me to back off just because I had feelings for her 4 years ago? That sounds like you have trust issues. That should be between you two, not me." Greg said, "What are you on about?" Aiden replied, "Are you good or are you just dumb?" Greg replied, "Excuse me?" Aiden said, "Yeah, you heard me. Why would you tell me to back off if it sounds like it's trust issues?" Greg began to lose his temper with Aiden as he didn't understand his point and just basically called stupid. Aiden continued by saying, "Why would I go talk to your girl if I know she hates me?" Aiden got caught off guard when Greg said, "I'm glad you know your place." Aiden replied, "What does that supposed to mean? You're calling me a dog?" That's when Greg responded, "And what if I did? What are you gonna do about it?" This is when Aiden got up and began to walk away. Greg then had the nerve to say, "Yeah, that's what I thought. Run away like a pussy that you are." That moment Greg said that, Aiden got flashbacks to the day his dad got drunk and began to call his mom a pussy for raising a weak boy. Aiden clenched his right fist and wasn't going to let another shitty guy call him and his mom a pussy. So he turned around and said, "Well, keep thinking, because a man would just walk away. Only an immature, ignorant child will try to say something to try and sound manly." Aiden continued walking, but Greg lost it completely. He lost his temper and sprinted at Aiden and began to throw punches. Aiden turned around to get caught in the mix. Greg hit Aiden with his right fist near the head and repeated it with a left hand, and then tried to use his elbows to try and hit Aiden. Aiden was forced to back up against the wall, and Greg pinned him down by grabbing both of his shoulders and slamming him into the wall. Aiden then grabbed Greg's right arm and then his left and began to push them off of him. Greg was caught off guard as Aiden's force wasn't allowing him to keep him pinned anymore. Then Aiden punched Greg near the left side of his neck. Greg let out a little groan of pain as he stepped back. That's when Aiden took off. Greg tried to swing his right fist at Aiden, but he punched him out of the way. And with his left, he punched Greg in the face and then the chest. Greg tried punching Aiden with his left, to which Aiden dodged and punched Greg in the back. Greg tried to hit with his left, but Aiden blocked it and punched Greg in the head and then the stomach. Greg tried swinging his right, and once again, Aiden blocked it and hit Greg in the head twice, and he proceeded to grab him by the neck and pulled him in, only to get punched in the head again. Greg stumbled, and that's when Aiden pulled him in again, but this time towards his knee, and kicked him with it in the face. He pulled him again and lifted him into the air and dropped him. Stephanie screamed, "No, babe." Greg lied there motionless with blood running down his nose. Aiden said, "Here's your wannabe boyfriend," and walked away. Stephanie began tearing up and began screaming for help. Just hearing her cries for help made Aiden's heart crumble into pieces. When Aiden had told Stephanie, "Here's your boyfriend," he didn't stare at her. He couldn't, because he still had feelings for her. Aiden walked into his fifth period class as the bell rang and lunch was over. Aiden knew he was going to get called up to the main office, but he knew he was in the right. Class began, and not even 5 minutes in, the security arrived to escort Aiden to the main office, where the principal was waiting. When Aiden entered, he was immediately surrounded by security and searched for weapons. The principal, Mr. Hans, said, "Aiden, I don't need to ask you if you know why you're here. I'm pretty sure you know." That's when Aiden responded, "Yeah, I got called in for my self-defense against Greg, right?" Mr. Hunt said, "Self-defense? You left Greg knocked out. He's still breathing, fortunately." Aiden replied, Well, he had it coming. His attitude was already aggressive. He came at me and tried to punch me. Mr. Hans responded, "We have cameras in the back. We saw the way you handed that kid his ass, and due to that, we're prohibiting anyone from hanging out back there, and we're suspending you for a day." Aiden then went to say, "Really? What about him? He's the one that started it." Mr. Hans then replied, "We will not tolerate behaviors like yours." Aiden then said, "So you don't tolerate self-defense?" Mr. Hans replied, "That's not what I'm saying." Aiden responded, "Sure, sounds like it." That didn't sit well with Mr. Hans, so he said, "You know what? Make it 2 days." Aiden couldn't believe it. He was beginning to be made out like the villain, even though he was in the right. That's when Aiden said, "But Mr. Hans, that isn't fair." "Life isn't fair," replied Mr. Hans. At that moment, Aiden was getting close to breaking, and it was now a few steps closer to the transition. Mr. Hans called Aiden's parents, but there wasn't a single ring. It was sent directly to voicemail. Mr. Hans looked at Aiden and said, "Saved by the ring, eh? But we're going to leave a message. And since no one picked up, you are going to stay with me here in the office." Aiden felt as if something was wrong from the moment his parents didn't pick up. Aiden closed his eyes and rolled his eyes while they were closed to avoid any other problems. Aiden was taken to his counselor's office, where they were giving to him some therapy sessions to see if there was any problem with him. The counselor began asking personal questions that Aiden felt he couldn't answer, as he would be giving up his actual emotions, and if they found out how he was broken, it would all be over for him. So Aiden began to lie so the real pain wouldn't be let out. When sixth period rolled around, the staff thought they had made progress with Aiden, but in reality, they hadn't. And that's also when Greg regained consciousness and woke up. Greg's parents were already there, and of course, they were in the hospital, and the police did get involved. During 5th and 6th period, word got around to Greg's friends about what had happened, and they began to plan something. When the bell rang and the school day was over, Aiden was left free to go home. Once Aiden made it to the front gates, a few kids began to give him the "go kill yourself" look. Aiden didn't pay attention and got the hell out of there ASAP. Once Aiden crossed the street, he began to make his way home fast by taking shortcuts, but not even that was helpful, as Greg's friends were hot on Aiden's trail. About 5 minutes into the walk home, Aiden began to hear footsteps behind them approaching fast. He waited for them to pass, but they didn't. But that's where the first mistake he did, as that made the group of friends surround him. Aiden quickly made count and saw there was only 5 total, with one of them being a little overweight. There was a slight standoff before Aiden said, "Get out of my way," to which they all responded, "No shot." Aiden said, "Well then, okay." He put his phone in his pocket and played one song in particular. Aiden took a deep breath and then made his first move, and he reached out to punch the guy in front of him, but quickly switched it to punch the fat guy in the back of the head. Instant knockout. The 4 guys rushed in together, punching Aiden's back, his chest, and his stomach. Aiden was taking the punches, and just as the beat dropped with the main verse, it was on. Aiden kicked one guy off of him, and then elbow hit the guy to his right, allowing him to punch the guy on his left. That then opened the door for him to 1v1 the last guy. The guy went in for the punch with his right hand, to which Aiden dodged and then caught the next one and performed an uppercut. The guy fell but wasn't done. Aiden seemed to throw a punch with his left, but it was a distraction as he threw the main one with his right hand. The guy stumbled and Aiden punched him in the chest. The guy fell, and then the 3 other guys came back for more. Aiden, enraged, kicked the guy in the sack, dropping him. The other 2 once again tried to gang up on him, but Aiden used his trick once more, throwing a punch in one direction and switching it to the last. One guy got the punch in the face, making him fall. Aiden then kicked the last guy in the sack, and it was over. All 5 guys dropped, knocked out. Aiden then began to continue his way home. Once Aiden was about to cross the street to get home, there was a loud pop noise that made him jump, but he didn't think anything of it. Then there were sirens heard. Aiden got to his front door and unlocked it and walked in, expecting to get yelled at for what happened. But when he looked straight ahead, he saw his mom sitting on the ground with blood on her clothing near her stomach. Aiden ran screaming, "Mom!" He tried to help her, but she reached out and grabbed his left cheek. She smiled and tried to say something, but couldn't. Then her hand dropped and went limp. Aiden said, "Mom," as tears came down his eyes, and they broke him when she didn't respond or move. She was gone. Dead. Aiden stood there in shock until he heard the sound of someone chugging a drink. He turned to see his dad holding a bottle of alcohol and a shotgun in the other hand. Aiden said, "What did you do?" His dad drank the alcohol and laughed, saying, "I solved the problem. I don't need pussies with me telling me what to do, and I certainly don't need a weakling that disobeys me." As he aimed the gun at Aiden, Aiden, enraged with all the anger from that day, ran straight at his dad. The father fired the gun, to which Aiden took, but with all the adrenaline he had, he lived the shot. Aiden kicked his dad, getting him down on the ground, and began punching him repeatedly. Aiden said, "You took the one person who cared." The dad laughed, but Aiden, having the dark thought in mind, he grabbed the butt of the gun and hit his dad in the head so hard it opened up. Aiden stood up and then heard the sounds of guns cocking. He turned his head and heard, "Put your hands up where we could see them." Aiden felt pain in his abdomen and went to touch it, but the police thought he was reaching for another weapon and shot him in the chest. Aiden fell on the ground, thinking, "Wow, this is it." Aiden's body hurt, not because he was shot twice, but also because of the fight he was in. Aiden laid there with tears in his eyes. The police had gotten there from reports of fighting, but came at the wrong time. As the officers walked up to check on Aiden's mom and dad, they noticed that Aiden was dying, and they tried to juice the truth out of him. They began to ask, "What did you do? Why did you do it? What caused you to do it?" Aiden was right there, seeing the light, when, "Psst, kid." Aiden looked to his right and could see a silhouette of someone. Aiden couldn't make out who it was. "Kid, I'm expanding the time you have left." Aiden was now starting to be in the stage where your brain can't piece stuff together, and asked, "What?" The officers were confused and kept questioning him. The thing was that most people have a guardian angel, but Aiden had something else watching him from the beginning, and now it was making its presence known. Aiden was slowly regaining recollection, but he was in a dark place. "We're in your mind, kid." Aiden was starting to realize that the voice was deep, and then it said, "I can give you life if you accept my offer." Aiden, being in his own head, was reliving all the painful memories of being hated and never loved by the two people he wanted it from, his father and Stephanie. But due to the lack of love he got, he was manipulated. "Do you swear to get revenge on those who have done you wrong?" Aiden said, "No, why not? All they did was break you and hate you. No love from anyone. But with my guidance, you can get what you want, what you truly desire." Aiden was still dying, and with no thinking straight, he began to think maybe it was a good offer. "Do you swear to get back at those who mistreated you and become the face of vengeance, or die and become the face of no love?" It took a second, and as it was about to repeat itself, Aiden said, "Yes." "Then rise. Rise again and live as my magician." The officers had declared Aiden dead, but then Aiden's body got up as if it was pulled. Aiden's arms stretched and his dark clothing began to wrap around him, and then his eyes went red. Then this thin chest plate manifested itself with a symbol representing the entity magician. The officers began to panic in confusion. "What the hell? What's going on?" Then Aiden dropped on his knees, wearing a caped hoodie. The officers demanded, "Put your hands in the air where we can see them." Aiden slowly looked up, and then he stood up, and that's when both officers shot at Aiden. But Aiden randomly reached out and caught the bullets and inspected them. Then Aiden began levitating. That's when the officers began unloading on Aiden. The bullets hit but bounced off of him. That's when Aiden grabbed one by the throat and began to electrocute him. The officer began to disintegrate into dust. The other officer began to call for backup, but got no response. When he checked why, he found out that his radio had been destroyed because of the electricity that had bounced off the other officer. When he looked up, Aiden punched right through his chest. Blood splattered everywhere. Aiden went outside and threw the cop cruiser a mile away without seeing, causing it to hit a gas truck, and on impact, exploded, killing 13 people total. Aiden went back to his house and picked up his mother's body and flew off into the sky. He was flying for a good hour or so. When Aiden landed, he was at the top of a mountain where he proceeded to bury his mother. He then snapped the twig in half and made a cross and placed some flowers on the makeshift grave and said, "I'm so sorry, Mom, that I wasn't there. I'm so sorry I failed you. I love you." Aiden dropped tears as he flew off into the sky. As Aiden flew, he asked, "So who are you exactly?" "I am an entity from the beyond," Aiden replied. "I'm assuming your name is Magician, right?" "An alias. I'm that of an unknown phantom," Aiden asked. "Why did you choose me?" "Because, Aiden, I have been watching you. You suffered. You weren't loved, but can change that. You will show the world that being hated comes with unforeseen consequences. Not all good." Aiden didn't understand, but he began to listen to this entity as if it were his mentor. "So when are you getting revenge on those who harmed you?" Aiden replied, "Tomorrow." There was a slight moment of silence, and then Aiden asked, "So can I not see you or something?" "You will, but for that I need my stone." Aiden replied, "Where is it?" "It's buried deep in the outskirts of Utah." Aiden said, "Say no more." The sun had gone down, but when Aiden arrived, there was paleontologists working in that area. Aiden landed and made himself known. There it was, on the table. Aiden took the stone. "Break it." Aiden broke the stone, and the mist began to appear. And from it, the unknown entity manifested. Everyone began panicking, so the entity killed them from existence. They all fell to the ground, lifeless. Then, the sight was erased from existence, and both Aiden and the entity disappeared into the night. When morning arrived, Aiden and entity began to arrive. The day started normal, but for Aiden, it was transition day. When they arrived, they waited on the top of the highest building in the school for lunchtime to arrive. When the time finally arrived, both Aiden and entity levitated over the quad where everyone hung out during lunch. Everyone began to point up. They were in disbelief. One person even said, "I heard it was a girl, not a guy." Both Aiden and entity heard it, but didn't care. 3, 2, 1. Aiden stretched his hands out and began to electrify everyone. Everyone began to run, but there was no point. They were getting hit either way. Bodies began falling over. As Aiden moved his hands around, he screamed and dropped a lot of tears. All the pain he had endured his entire life, he was letting them out. He was showing them how it felt. Eventually, Aiden made eye contact with Stephanie and didn't hold back. He electrified her till she was dead. Mr. Hans stepped outside and only to get punched through the chest with blood splattering everywhere. Aiden then said, "Life isn't fair," as he laughed with a crazed, deranged look on his face. When Aiden was done, he took off into the sky. You see, Aiden wasn't given the proper love he deserved, and because of it, he wasn't able to make the right choice, right from wrong. He was easily manipulated, and because of no love from his father or that special someone, Aiden had become a monster that would be lurking in the shadows forever.